All right, good morning. My name is Adam Milnor. I'm an outdoor recreation planner for the Bureau of Land Management. I live in Portland, and I work for the Salem District. Before I get started, I want to say it's been a great week here, and it's obvious that I've got some Southwest experience myself, but there's a ton of very dedicated folks down here working on some tough issues. So here's this whole presentation is like the previous one, designed to give you guys a little bit of a feel for, you know, what's happening in another part of the country, which is some pretty cool stuff. So my project is looking at a dam removal project that was a little bit farther along. This is the Marmot Dam. It's on the Sandy River outside of Portland, Oregon. This one's in Oregon. This is the Sandy directly downstream of the dam. Hopefully everyone has those experiences where you look at stuff and you go, wow, it's pretty cool that I'm even somewhat associated with that. This is a boulder rapid on the Sandy River. It's a class 4 and it's super fun. So what I'm going to give an overview of is kind of, I'm not an engineer, I'm not a hydrologist, I'm a rec guy who's been managing this project for about 5 years. So what I want to give you today is just a little bit of a bigger picture overview, utilizing this as a case study of, you know, this is a process from a dam removal perspective that's happening a lot. So in the past 15 years, we've had 300 dams removed. There's different estimates of how many could be removed or how many will be removed, but these are just absolutely fascinating projects to watch, to be involved in, to work on. So, you know, this is some really exciting stuff. And fortunately, Marmot was one of the first large scale dam removals that happened in the Northwest. So when you talk about Condit, the Rogue River, Savage Rapids, and then eventually the Elwha is kind of the granddaddy up to this point. Marmot was sort of the first one where the dynamite got brought out. And so it's been very heavily studied, very heavily watched. And so what I'm going to share today is just some interesting kind of notes about the repercussions of these projects, both for land management agencies and a little bit on the resource side. So Marmot Dam, what dam? We'll go over that. It's hard not to show some cool videos and pictures. How are we managing it? And what's, you know, really some lessons learned? Like if you're involved in something like this, you know, if I could go back in a time machine, the things I would tell myself. So I'm gonna show a really cool video to give you an idea of the resource that we're working with. So this was a. So the Sandy is a little bit different resource than what you guys are dealing with down here. So this is from a flood in 2011. The river originates on Mount Hood before flowing down to the Columbia. In February of 2011, there's also some cool music. We haven't had any cool music this week. So in February, there was a large rain on snow event on Mount Hood where 10 inches came down in 24 hours. And this was the result. So the Sandy, and I'll kind of talk over this about what kind of a river it is. It's like Russ pointed out, a lot of things about rivers in the Northwest are based on their relationship to the dams. And so the Sandy is one of those rivers that it's the largest river that comes in below Bonneville that's undammed now. The river supports 4 runs of anadromous fish, so salmon, steelhead, and I'll show some pictures of some cool-looking fish here soon. So it's actually in remarkably pristine condition overall. It's mostly publicly owned by the Forest Service and the BLM. It's the water source for the city of Portland. And so people have been fighting over this basin for a little while. It's a good one. Yeah, that's good thing that's not your house, right? This is Lolo Pass Road. This was absolutely incredible. On a side note, I'm evaluating this segment for eligibility and inclusion of the Wild Scenic River system. So, all right. Pretty, yeah, there's big trees. It's hard not to just stay on this for the whole 3 minutes because it gets better, but I have other stuff to talk about. Here's my obligatory watershed map. You see up here is Mount Hood. Up here is the Columbia. The city of Portland, basically the suburbs go right there. The bottom of the river is essentially an urban environment. The salmon accident actually is a tributary, is the one of the only rivers that's fully protected under the Wild and Scenic Rivers Act for its whole length. Another interesting note, that entire watershed, which is the water source for the city of Portland, is completely closed to public access. It's 100,000 acres. So Marmot Dam removal, how did this thing happen? Similar dynamics at work to what Russ said. So this was a FERC license that Portland General Electric had to renew. When all of our fish species got listed as threatened under ESA in 1998, that required new conditions of these power companies, and the economics changed quite a bit. So Marmot had a fish ladder to help fish like this. This is a lucky guy. That's a Chinook salmon. We've probably eaten some of them. They're very cool to look at in a river. They're just amazing, amazing fish. I could talk about that for a long time. So there was a settlement agreement, and Russ did a good job of outlining how that process typically works. There was 23 parties. The BLM was a party for two reasons. One, the land underlying the actual project site was federal land that had been withdrawn since 1903. And we also manage a Wild and Scenic River segment downstream of the dam, which required us to do a Section 7 determination and evaluate how those pieces fit. So PGE also had, like PacifiCorp, had a lot of land associated with the project, about 1,500 acres that, you know, they're not really in the land management business if you don't have a dam there anymore. So they had to find someone to take all that over. And this is one of those pieces, those dominoes that falls as part of these huge scale projects that eventually, as part of the settlement agreement where there was 23 parties, those are big meetings, those before my time, it was identified that the BLM, through a system of land conservancies and eventually purchases, would acquire and purchase all of this property. So now the BLM, with some other exchanges, manages 6,000 acres of new land up there. So you can kind of see it's not just about dam removal. There's a whole bunch of things that spin off from that, and I'll talk about that as well. In the settlement agreement, it talked about the site itself, what would happen to it, somewhat vague, and we'll get into that. So the dam itself was a 47-foot high concrete dam. It is, at this point, the largest dam to be removed in the history of the state of Oregon. There's a really cool footbridge in front of it, too, which I can talk a little bit about. But you see that was on blast day right there, and then shortly after, there's nothing there. So we worked closely with PGE in dealing with this site. The way this was removed, I'm going to show a video of the actual removal of all this sediment moving through, which is really cool. But it was a less complicated project than Condit. It was cofferdam built behind the concrete dam. The channel was dewatered. They removed the concrete dam and then let this river have at the earthen cofferdam. So that's the next video we're going to show here. So like I said, this was very heavily studied. The USGS has a full published study on this. It got international attention because this is a hot topic, and it came right at the point where many of these were coming out. So there you are. This is a guy that's a forklift going out on top of this thing. I hope he got hazard pay. He's going to go notch this thing out. So there's the river starting to seep through this thing. Oop, he notches it, and there it goes. This is in 24 hours. Similar to Condit, there was a lot of sediment behind this. There was 1 million cubic yards of sediment. This is a navigable waterway. So that sediment belonged to the state of Oregon, and there was some back and forth about how that would be dealt with. Eventually, it was determined that let's let the river eat it the same way that the white salmon did. So some of the things that we're planning for Condit and other projects came from some of the lessons learned on this. This is a powerful river. In terms of water flow, I mean, right now this river has 2,500 CFS in it. It's a river you probably even never heard of. The Colorado here in Grand Junction has 2,250 at the moment. So this is the area right around there, and this is a whole topic in and of itself. You can see in the first top photo, this is right afterwards, there was kind of these steep banks that were there. There was the right after the removal, there was 20-foot high walls of cobble that had been collecting there for 100 years. And, when you boated through it, it was a really kind of a trippy experience. So I got to watch, and a lot of us got to watch over the years as this was flushed downstream and into that gorge I showed you in that first photo. A lot of that collected and formed new bars, and we're feeling the effects now. There's 30 river miles below where this dam site was, unlike the white salmon where it was just 3 miles. So if you know the river, it's been really fun to watch all of that stuff move down. So there you are on the bottom. It's sort of what it looks like today, more or less. The channel has migrated substantially. It's really cool to go there and stand on that footbridge I showed you in the previous picture and take a look at it. You'll see similar safety issues as Russ was talking about. That's a huge wall. That's a shotcrete wall that was a wing wall of the dam. It's a viewing area that we're going to talk about the plans for the site. But with these things, you're always going to have, there's a reality of the site itself that has to be taken care of. You know, it sounds great to free up a bunch of spawning habitat and everything else. But I guess the focus of my presentation, when we get to lessons learned, is you need to think about the details. Again, there's a nice study about this if you want to look at it. Really just fascinating stuff. I'm not a geomorphologist, although that's a cool title. But I find this stuff fascinating. And I encourage anyone who wants to know about this stuff to look up a lot of these resources. There's in the Northwest, there's been an incredible library of scientific information built around these removals. So that leaves, this is kind of where I come in as the BLM, and you're left with this site. So here you have the dam itself before. There was a system of canals. There was a huge concrete settling pad in the middle. There was a road system. The whole thing's about 5 acres. This is the river below. There's a USGS gauging station right here. And there's kind of a road that goes down right there. So also, this is the only accessible river access point for 20 miles of this river. The lower portion, not only the on-river use, but all of it, you know, probably sees in excess of 500,000 visitors per year. So this is a segment upstream that's now free-flowing that offers us some pretty cool recreation opportunities, right? So we came out with a plan as quickly as we could while there was massive excavators on site to still move some of this material, and hopefully you're picking up on a lesson learned. Think ahead, or try to. Don't scramble for this step. But we developed a conceptual site. I'll kind of go back and forth so that kind of makes sense there. A conceptual site plan for what the site would look like. Day use only, although we're going to hopefully open it up to overnight use by permit. Parking areas, shelters, a host pad, a boat ramp. This is that footbridge I showed you that we decided to retain. Do engineering studies first before you agree to taking over a bridge. Just a heads up. And then that kind of area right by the wall, that's right there. Weddings, viewpoints, a lot of interpretive opportunities. All of this was contained in an activity level management plan that we developed in 2009. Like I said, we acquired 6,000 acres. This is between Mount Hood and Portland. It's pretty cool country. It's a rainforest. There's lots of neat things you can do with it. Big fish projects came out of this. I was sort of the rec guy, and I had the good fortune of writing some of this my second summer with the BLM. That was fun. This is our benefits-based management framework. This is a little rec plug right here. You know, what are we targeting for this site in terms of experiences, benefits? What's the setting prescription that we're going to look at for this site? And so that has driven us to kind of figure out in this interim, before we can develop the site, how we're going to deal with public access. As you can imagine, there's a demand for people to go down there, but simultaneously we have safety hazards, a similar situation to Condit. So what we've done is we've kept it gated a quarter mile up. You're allowed to walk down. We have some very limited signage that indicates that, you know, being outside is inherently dangerous. And we've allowed, through our special recreation permit program, some outfitters and guides to use the site because, like I said, it's one of the only places to access the river. So we kind of have a little interim strategy here to allow people to access it, but once they sign that, they're not going to hold the U.S. government liable. We've also got some requests for weddings. A quick anecdote, I got a request for a wedding a year ago. It was 100 people. By the time I got out there to meet the guy, it was 300 people, and they asked me if it was a flight path because to PDX Airport because they had some laser light shows that they would like to incorporate. And I realized very quickly that I was faced with a permit application for a rave, which I denied. Managing land is really fun if you guys don't get to do that. It's pretty wacky. So here's what we're left with, right? This is literally the site as it's being decommissioned. So think this is all forest around it, obviously. This place gets about 70 inches of rain every year. The river is right here. The footbridge is right there. The dam was directly upstream of it. But this is the kind of stuff that you're going to be faced with. And there was not a clear plan in that settlement agreement. Lots of talk about how you're going to manage sediment downstream. Lots of talk. We're going to talk your ear off about that. Hey, how do you get rid of that huge pipe? Oh, maybe we hadn't thought of that as clearly as we should have. And this was one of the first projects of this scale. So no knock to anyone. There's just, like I said, the devil's in the details. So how do you take this and turn it into this? I haven't slept a couple nights thinking about that, but there's a number of ways to do this. So we had them grade some of that. We brought in a lot of soil. We have a cool machine that I'm going to show you here shortly. Another trick is if you're really close to a Forest Service regional office / BLM state office, they'll give you money to host events to give them a place to do field work. So that's a really good idea. Being close to a regional state office is not a bad idea. So that's I've made sure this is on people's radar. And so this is how it looks today, which is pretty cool. So what we did was we came in, it was graded gravel essentially. So think basically like an industrial site. We came in, we seeded it, we hydro seeded it. We tried a couple pilot plantings. They did not work very well. Extremely harsh conditions. I mean, for Oregon, our native plants aren't really meant to grow on a gravel bar that much. I mean, this is kind of upland from the river a little bit, but you know, really sun-baked kind of thing. So we tried a few different things, and then we came in and essentially we took these areas where this is going to be a meadow. So we kind of left that as hydro seeding. This is a few years of grass growing. The Northwest is kind of lush. This is an area that we ripped. We put soil on top of it. We ripped it with this machine. That's my favorite picture of this of the presentation. Feel free to come up with a nickname for it. I haven't yet. But we ripped it with that machine, and then we came in and we planted a couple thousand plants there. So it's pretty cool. I mean, from a landscape architecture perspective, you know, this is like a total blank slate. You know, it's kind of the dream here to go, oh, well, it's a blank slate, it's harsh, whatever, but we're going to do some cool stuff. So then we built these paths that were in here, and then we've been kind of revegetating around that. A side note, the detail business here, from a rec standpoint, the railings on this, you know, were not necessarily meant for small children for river viewing. So those are things you have to think ahead of time. Oh, we want a bridge there. Please, power company, keep the bridge. Well, how is that bridge actually going to be used? Now we're transitioning into lessons learned here. I think I've got still a few more minutes. So, you know, be explicit about your desired condition and articulate that loudly and frequently. So that conceptual plan we developed, that was concurrent with their decommissioning. So literally while they're blowing things up, we're writing our conceptual plan. That's a little too late. That seems obvious, but this happens all the time. Be explicit about what you want it to be, and the details will emerge from that. You want to keep a footbridge? Okay, well, the thing about these FERC proceedings is this is incredibly powerful time to get stuff done. Incredibly powerful. There's amazing things happening around these projects that are required by FERC. It's the most powerful tool that you will see in your watershed ever. So use it. Secure tangible commitments while all parties are at the table and public interest is highest. You know, when PacifiCorp is a great company, and they're gonna let people know that they did something good by removing that dam, and they're gonna have press releases, and they're gonna make a rather big deal about it. Portland General Electric, who we worked with, did the same thing, and by all means they should. That's when you get your project into the press release. You know, vague commitments about public access or everything else, that's great. That should be, that's the foundation. But it would be, it's easier while there's 23 parties around the table to say, please commit to helping me build a boat ramp, rather than the dam is removed, I go back and I go, PGE, do you want to help out with this? You just imagine what is firmer footing for you as a person working through this project. Focus on infrastructure first, then rehab, all while disturbance is highest. So when you have that huge just destruction type situation, you really want to take that time to put in your infrastructure, your paths, other things. We use like the rubbleized dam to redo the roads and build those trails. That's pretty cool. So you have all this material, you know, the dam is sitting there. You should use it. I have a bunch of pieces in my cubicle. It's kind of nice. This is the river kind of upstream from that. You can see it sort of stabilizing. It's coming through, and now a lot of boaters go through. We had a cool article in the New York Times about it. Oh, and then, of course, you always want to use pretty pictures to convince people they should care. This is directly downstream of the dam. It's obviously a very nice river. It's beautiful, and you know, we have to realize, for as much as there's a lot of technical work that goes into this, you know, the decisions that are made on this site are not going to be entirely based on that USGS geomorphic report. They're going to be based on emotions and people at these entities feeling a connection to this project and to this site. And the sooner that you realize that, you always have to have your backup in terms of the data and the hard facts, but you have to utilize people's, like I said, those volunteer days. That's a small example. There are many bigger examples than that. But you know, we can't forget the human component in these things, because you know, we're the ones that built the dam 100 years ago and then blew it up. So we have to keep in mind that this is people working through this. So this is the Sandy, that's Mount Hood, and I'm finished. Any questions?